But born out of this is opportunity. And that's one of the things that so many people are missing, Dean, because they don't understand that the tax planning element of the overall arching financial plan can put perhaps more dollars in your pocket than any other part of the plan.
But here we are just a few days after the tax filing deadline of April 18th here in 2023. And right. we can be thankful for a couple of things here. Thankful that the craziness of the tax filing season is behind us. Thankful for the hardworking CPAs who go the extra mile during that time of year.
Hear, hear.
And also thankful for the fact that we are now in what you and I consider to be one of the most opportune times of the year, and that is the tax planning season. And there's no better time to get started doing tax planning than right after the tax filing season. Why? Because you already have all of your documents together, everything that affects your financial life, you've had to comb through, bring together, and provide that information in preparation of your tax return. And people so loathe the tax filing season that they just want to take all that stuff and stick it in a drawer and not think about it again until next year when they have to go through the same exercise. If you do that, that's the wrong approach. That's kind of the ostrich with their head in the sand type of an approach. You're not going to be able to control the amount of taxes that you pay. And remember, as long as a person lives in the United States and either has money or makes money, taxes are going to be a fact of life. So what can we do, Bud, right now to start lowering the tax burden that a person has, not just in a single year, but over their lifetime?
Sure. Well, first off, tax planning is an essential part of the planning process. In fact, many times it is directionally, placing the person in a position where they can now start to control their taxes better, perhaps than they ever have in their past. So as we address those situations, first off, we want to know what's changing the tax code this year that could impact me in this new year that we're talking about here. And so if you're not working with a professional who's staying up to speed with that, and that's why we have CPAs with inside our firm to actually help us maneuver or navigate, you know, what any new rules that went into effect here in the current year that weren't applied in the previous year. So that happens quite often, and it's our responsibility, the CPA's responsibility, to keep us up to speed associated with that. But born out of this is opportunity, and that's one of the things that so many people are missing, Dean, because they don't understand that the tax planning element of the overall arching financial plan can put perhaps more dollars in your pocket than any other part of the plan.
Yeah, when you think about taxes, you have to think about taxes really as an expense in retirement. And if you think about the two things that people will spend the most money on during their retirement years, it is typically going to be taxes and healthcare, right? So healthcare, people take the time, they shop for the insurance. When they get on Medicare, they're looking for the right supplemental plan that covers the prescription drugs that they're on. And they take the time to do that because they believe that that's something that is within their control. Yet when it comes to taxes, people have believed that taxes are just a matter of fact. They are what they are, and I'm going to owe what I'm going to owe. Well, the fact of the matter is, as we said at the beginning of the show, you have a unique ability to control your taxes during your retirement years, unlike any other time of your life. And being able to control your taxes during your retirement years actually begins before you retire. And the reason that it begins before you retire is because every single thing that you're putting your money into to save for retirement is going to have an ultimate tax consequence when the money comes out. So in other words, you're going to have a bucket of money that you've already paid taxes on. It might be in a brokerage account, titled in a trust or a joint tenancy, or even an individual name with a TOD on it or something like that, where each and every year, capital gains, dividends, interest, etc., are taxable. That's your taxable bucket. Money's already been paid on that. You then have your tax deferred bucket. And that tax deferred bucket is the traditional IRA or the traditional 401k or a non-qualified tax deferred annuity where you've paid taxes on some of the money. Maybe you paid taxes on some of the money before it went in, but all of the earnings and potentially all of the contributions, if they're all deductible contributions, have never been taxed before. And the delay of taxation on that can allow it to compound better. But when you start taking that money out, you then have a taxable event. That money comes out and is taxed as ordinary income. And then you have our favorite vehicle, which is the Roth IRA and the Roth 401k. The Roth IRA and 401k, you put money in but after you've paid the tax, and then all of your earnings forevermore are tax-free. Mm-hmm. Now, there are some stipulations. Money has to be in that Roth IRA for at least 5 years. You have to have attained age 59 and a half before you can start taking the money out tax-free. But you can always take out of a Roth IRA. The contributions can always be taken out tax-free. And there's no 5-year time frame on the Roth IRA contributions. So it's complicated. But where you're saving that money before retirement will, by and large, give you a big impact on how much money you're going to get to keep when you start taking money out during your retirement years.
Yeah, yesterday, Dean, I was with one of our larger clients who has a 401k plan for his company. And we were talking about Secure Act 2.0, which you are highly familiar with. And but we were talking about it because I made mention of the fact that now corporations have the ability of doing some matching on a tax-free basis to 401k contributions that are going in, which we have never had before. Now, it's up to the corporation as to whether they want to do that or not, but at least we've turned a corner on that so we don't have a tax-deferred bucket in a tax-free bucket, you know, right, from that perspective. But it was encouraging, you know, that we have that direction to go to because it's making it a little bit more pure in terms of both my contributions and my matches coming in with tax-free. You know, we have a big event that's coming up, and we keep closing in a little tighter on it, and that's 2026, and that's when the taxes revert back to the old Obamacare at that time. And that creates an opportunity, Dean. The opportunity is for us to do Roth conversions up to that point because the chances of those conversions having more tax after that date is probable.
Right.
You know, so we need to address that now while we can. And I've never done more Roth conversions than we did last year. And I think we're going to have probably the same factor again for this year. Is that true for you as well?
Yeah. You know, the thing is, when you're talking about Roth conversions, let's be clear on what that is for those people that are hearing us on radio, whether you're listening to us on the podcast or watching us on YouTube. The Roth conversion is simply taking money from a traditional IRA or a traditional 401k and converting it to a Roth IRA or a Roth 401k. Now, when you do that conversion, it causes a taxable event in the year that you do it. So you're essentially going to pay taxes one time, and then once it gets into the Roth, all the future earnings, all the future distribution, all the future growth is going to be totally tax-free. So sometimes you can convert where it makes an awful lot of sense, right? And I've seen most cases doing conversions makes sense, but not in all cases. I'll give you a specific example.
Okay.
Last year, prior to the end of the year, we were about October timeframe, and was reviewing with one of my clients. She's a widow, and she's saying, okay, well, we were doing Roth conversions before my husband passed away. Should I do Roth conversions this year? When we went in and plugged in the Roth conversion into our tax calculator, we said no. And the reason we said no was because her income level was at a point where only just a couple thousand dollars of her Social Security was taxable. The moment we started doing more Roth conversions, 85 cents of every dollar up to another almost $30,000 of her Social Security was taxable. So
because she's a single filer.
Because she's a single filer now. So what it did was for every dollar that we converted from a traditional to a Roth, it cost $1.85 to be taxable because it caused more of her Social Security to become taxable.
Sure.
And so in that scenario, you know, we ran the plan. And of course, she was fine by not having it. And yes, she's going to leave a little bit more money in a traditional to her kids than a Roth, which is not quite as effective. But when we factored in that it was causing $1.85 to become taxable for every dollar that we converted, it didn't work within the overall plan. It actually reduced the amount of money that her beneficiaries would receive in the future.
And my reaction to that is shame on Congress. You know, why in the world would the survivor of a couple have to pay a higher tax rate than when the couple was together? It's my fate. I just think it's shameful from that perspective. But we got to live with it, right?
It's the way the tax code is written.
Yeah.
Right?
And so therefore, you know, we want to use that tax code to the greatest ability of mitigating the amount of tax someone pays. But you bring up a great example, and most people don't even realize that that is in somebody's future.
Right.
You know,
another thing that people need to consider is, especially you brought up the Tax Cuts and Jobs Act sunsetting at the end of 2025. Now
that's the old Trump program.
Yeah. So there's a couple of things with that I think are critical. One of the big things that the Tax Cuts and Jobs Act did, besides bringing down the marginal rates a little bit, was it almost eliminated the ability to itemize on your tax return. So the vast majority of people today are taking the standard deduction,
which is as high as I've ever seen it.
It is. Well, when the Tax Cuts and Jobs Act reverts, your ability to reduce that income or to itemize is going to come back to the way it was before, because sure, your standard deduction is going to be lower. So why would we bring that up in a tax planning show? Well, because if you're simply doing the standard deduction and you've got 2023, 2024, and 2025, that's 3 years. If you're charitably inclined, and let's just say for an example that you're giving $10,000 a year or $15,000 a year to various charities, you could do what's called a donor advised fund, where you can make all 3 years of those charitable contributions in a single year here in 2023, get the benefit of deducting that and being able to itemize on your tax return. And then you simply take the money out of the donor advised funds and you write the checks to the different charities that you want that to go to, therefore giving you the benefit of getting a tax deduction for that charitable contribution. Then in 2026, you can go back to your normal charitable contributions and you can start to deduct those again, and you can start to itemize again, assuming that there's no change in the tax code between now and then, which I don't think Congress can keep their hands off of it that long.
Yeah. And isn't it wonderful for our viewers as well as our listeners, if you will, to understand that there's options out there. But as you can tell from Dean's accurate description, it's complicated.
Right.
You know, you better get lined up with the people that know what they're doing to take advantage of it properly.
The other thing that you should be doing right now is you should be thinking, if you're over the age of 70 and a half, doing your qualified charitable distributions out of your IRA early in the year. Now, for those of you that aren't familiar with it, a qualified charitable distribution, or a QCD, is where money comes directly out of your retirement account and goes directly to charity, and it never shows up on your tax return. So,
because it's not taxed.
Right. So if you're 70 and a half, that's how you should be giving to charity. 72 is the magic number for RMDs, or 73 soon.
Yep.
So it's actually 73 this year, because they just changed that. Sorry about
that's
that.
Right. That's okay.
So if you're going to be 73 this year, you also have to take a required minimum distribution. So why should you do your QCDs early? Your QCDs will reduce the amount of your required minimum distribution. So if you went in early in the year and you just said, here's how much I have to take out, I might as well take it out now. Mm-hmm. Well, then you have to pay taxes on the whole thing.
Right.
If you,
and that's what people have traditionally done for years.
Right. So, but if you are charitably inclined, do that QCD first and it'll reduce the amount of your required minimum distribution.
Yeah.
So that should be done early in the year.
It's one of the best benefits that we've ever seen that the Congress has come out with. You know, the fact that we can actually, we're going to give to the charity anyway, but the fact that we don't have to pay the tax on it to take the deduction, which won't be as great as the tax-free status given it to the charity, this is one great aspect of what they finally did.
Right. So let's go deeper into the whole tax planning aspect. We're talking about some techniques here and some things that people should be considering here early in the year. But the tax planning techniques really is a forward-looking projection of your tax liability over a lifetime. And so in order to get it done properly, you have to have a certified financial planner start the whole process. And many people are going to think that, well, the tax planning is all about my CPA. Well, CPA needs to be there, but they need to follow a CFP that has done a complete plan. That way the CPA has the entire picture. They know all of the resources. They know what all of the spending objectives are. They know how much Social Security is going to be there. They know what inheritances are expected in the future, et cetera. That list goes on and on. Once you have that understanding, then you can start to say, all right, we need to spend money every year in order to enjoy our retirement. Where should we get that money from?
Right.
Which account and how much and in what order should we spend that money? Once you have the CPA come in and do that tax overlay on the financial plan that the certified financial planner's done, then you can start to say, if you spend in this manner versus that manner, here's the difference in the impact of taxes for the next 10, 15, 20, 25 years. And I was working with one of our certified financial planners on a case here, gosh, it's been maybe about a month or two ago, bud, where how the CPA suggested we adjust the spending or where it was coming from and then sprinkled in some Roth conversions on a very tactical basis, the difference in the total tax over a lifetime, assuming that this person lived to 95 years old, mm-hmm. the difference in total tax was over $360,000 less
right.
in taxes, right? So remember when I said taxes are one of your biggest expenses in retirement? And taxes are not just a matter of fact. You can control them, but you really need to have that certified financial planner create a real financial plan, not something that's kind of back of the envelope math saying, oh yeah, rule of 4%, whatever. No, it's got to be detailed. And then the CPA can actually have a larger impact. The CPA is reacting when they're preparing a tax return. You want that CPA to be proactive and doing damage control before the damage actually occurs by creating that plan.
Sure. And if we go back to Roth conversions and the tax implications of that, our CPAs create a spreadsheet. And what the spreadsheet will be option one, option two, option three. And clearly on this spreadsheet, they will be able to see what the tax implications are if they do a certain amount 1 year and a certain amount the next year and so on and so forth. But it gives the client the ability of controlling their own destiny and realizing how much tax they may or may not want to pay in a given period of time. They might have some other uses for the money that they don't want to do it in a specific year, but it's our job to show the benefit of the strategy associated with it, have it confirmed by the CPA, and then let the client make the ultimate decision as to the direction they want to go.
Yeah, and if you start talking about Roth conversions, bud, the other thing that will come directly into play with Roth conversion techniques is the timing of when a person should claim their Social Security. And the reason that that's important is because Social Security is taxed different than any other asset that you have. Social Security by itself is a tax-free source of income, but people disqualify themselves from having their Social Security be tax-free by having too much of something called provisional income. And the provisional income is a special calculation that's used to determine how much, if any, of your Social Security is taxable. Now, one of the things that we know will cause more Social Security to become taxable is more ordinary taxable income. Well, when you're doing a Roth conversion from a traditional to a Roth, that's causing more ordinary income. So you have to ask yourself, if I want to get Roth conversions done, but I'm eligible for Social Security at 62. Should I start my Social Security, or will it interfere with my ability to convert as much money as I want to in retirement? And what's the right mix there?
Sure.
And the CPA, if the financial plan's built properly, the CPA can come in and say, okay, if you delay your Social Security, here's what that Social Security benefit's going to be in the future, and this is how much more money we can convert and pay the same amount of taxes. This is the overall impact on the plan. And sometimes just simply doing Roth conversions is a compelling reason to delay the Social Security benefits, which can come out if you get Roth conversions and you get to age 70, 71, 72, 73, and then all your income off the Roth is tax-free, well, guess what? That means your Social Security is going to be tax-free too.
Right. And folks, you want provisional income because you probably can't live on Social Security by itself. But how we control the provisional income from a distribution perspective, and obviously the taxation on that, becomes the art form associated with it. Because if you think of it simply in terms of buckets, you've got a tax-deferred, a tax-free, and a taxable bucket. It's the coordination of the income, possibly out of all three, possibly out of two of the three, that is going to create the ultimate tax conclusion of that. And therefore, see it in black and white. Understand that you actually can control this, but you want to be able to confirm that you've done it intelligently.
You know, it's interesting, but as you're talking, I'm kind of smiling over here because I think
you are smiling.
Well, so I just happened to log in to my 401k statement the other day, and I log in and it's showing me how much my Social Security is going to be and how much income I'm going to be able to get out of my 401k based on my contribution limits and age, et cetera. And I smile because I think that's not right.
Yes.
It's not right. Yet that is what the vast majority of people that are heading into retirement, that's their version of a financial plan. Well, guess what? Even if those numbers are right, that's not how much money you spend. And guess what? Even if that number's right and that's how much money you spend, that's not how much money you're going to get, because you don't know what the tax impact is going to be when these things turn on.
Right. And most of the 401k plans has that online service, if
right.
you will.
That's what I'm talking
and
about.
And it shoots it up and it goes, oh, congratulations, and you're going to have this much, you know, in retirement and all that, with no understanding at all the tax implications, or whether that's really a valid number or something that's that has been created agnostic of all the other issues that have to be understood.
Well, we have a saying, it's not how much you make, it's how much you get to keep.
Right.
And controlling taxes allows you to keep more of what you make.
Yeah.
That's why it's critical to develop the financial plan with a certified financial planner, have the CPA in the same room. Or maybe they can be virtual, but they've got to be working together. That CPA has to be intimately familiar with the financial plan and the overall situation. Then you begin to create a scenario where you're controlling your taxes and you're paying less than what you ever thought possible.
And I want our listeners and our viewers to think of us next week, because Dean and I will be with Ed Slott, America's IRA expert, going through all the tax implications associated with what's new and new.
All right, here we go. Thanks for joining us on America's Wealth Management Show. I'm Dean Barber along with Bud Casper. We'll be back with you next week, same time, same place.
The views expressed represent the opinion of Barber Financial Group, an SEC-registered investment advisor. Information provided is for illustrative purposes only and does not constitute investment, tax, or legal advice. BFG does not accept any liability for the use of the information discussed. Consult with a qualified financial, legal, or tax professional prior to taking any action.